Very briefly, so this was the topic that of our project, and in the last 1 year we've done a whole bunch of things. So one of the main thing was a series of stories on Bengaluru's biodiversity. We looked at the ecosystem, we looked at how it intersects with citizens' lives and livelihoods. And first and foremost, it was a wonderful chance for us and our writers to actually look at the joy of nature, to just go observe. There was this really nice story done by Aarti Kumar Rao, which looked at the bees in our, like in her own little balcony. And it's just so the complex and amazing, stories that you can get out of just sitting and looking at what are the different life forms in our own, nearby areas. So that was a great chance to do that. And then we also looked at, the impact of our own, behavior activities, the human activities on nature, on biodiversity as well. So for example, this story looked at how just by having these like big bright lights in the evenings, how that affects the artificial light affects nature's processes, right? A lot of, for example, dung beetles look at the Milky Way to kind of, align themselves. And these are small creatures actually get affected because of all of this. Even birds and many animals are impacted. And then we looked at all the over the years, what has been the changes in the city, the losses that we have experienced. One, of course, we know about the lakes, for example. Mohit looked at all these little kuntes, and these are smaller, which are not considered lakes by the government, but they're still important areas of biodiversity. And these small water bodies are fast disappearing, and of course, because of urbanization and real estate development and so on. And what is the impact of their disappearance on the the local ecosystem there? And it also not just about nature, but it also actually affects people's and livelihoods as well. And we saw a picture that had talked about the crop varieties that are disappearing, the impact on animals like the slender loris and so on. After that, we also looked at some of the bigger projects. There are like, for example, you have this huge plan to develop a film city in Hesargatta. And that actually is a space where this rare animals have been spotted. And for example, the lesser florican is a very endangered species, and it's been spotted after 100 years. And this is home to like dozens of butterflies, hundreds of like other creatures, which are not, and there are migrant birds which are coming in from as far away as Siberia, Eurasia, and so on. And what is going to happen to it if you convert this and actually set up a film city there? So there is a campaign, but as of now, there is the project seems to be continuing, and it is still on the anvil. Then we also looked at the challenges within government. There are the way the Banu talked about the real estate clearances that are obtained. It's just so much easier. The whole process doesn't consider the impact on biodiversity itself. And there is actually a biodiversity body within the local municipal corporation, and that's still not like really active in doing much. So all of this, the governance aspect was also critical, and we looked at that as well. And then we also explored some of the solutions, saying these can still be fixed. You can still have livelihoods can be protected if you can engage communities in restoration of lakes. You can have real estate projects less impactful on the environment by actually having a better process for this clearance, right? So all of this was also considered. So this was a very interesting series, about a dozen stories that we did. Very, these were, deep diving into issues, very complex issues. And we learned a lot, and so did our readers. And after that, of course, we had this contest for to engage with young people. We invited students to come and observe what they could see in their own backyard or garden, and asked them to send their stories, and in the form of like either articles or as Instagram posts. So we got a lot of entries there. Ekta will have more about that later. In addition, we also had, this morning, we actually had a workshop for journalists on how they can cover biodiversity. And as part of that, there were also two manuals which were released. One was on for scientists and how they can communicate with journalists. And one was meant for journalists and how they can report about science and environment. And of course, now I'm going to hand it to Karthik. And we had this very little multimedia story, but it was such a pleasure doing that. And I'm going to allow Karthik to talk a little more about that experience.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. Thank you, Meera. I'm here to briefly show everyone an illustrated story that we'll be publishing on Monday, this coming Monday, on both the websites, Monga Bay India and Citizen Matters. And it's a story dedicated on Bangalore's lakes. We cannot do a Bangalore environmental series without getting to the lakes. So while we did a detailed story, a couple of detailed stories on the lakes, we thought of coming up with a different sort of an idea, a different form of an execution to involve various facets of the lakes and show how it's connected to the wildlife, people's jobs, flood, urban heat, and link everything in one story, and also come up with a different format to do so. Can we go to the next slide, please? So we thought of executing that in the form of a A to Z series. We easily found aspects for each alphabet, and in fact, we'll have a lot of surplus as well. There are many, many things that are associated with lakes. And what we did was we worked with a mixed media artist, Lebuni Roy, who's based in Bangalore, who doesn't leave an opportunity to visit the lake, she said. She couldn't be here today because she had some other work. But what she did was, during her walks, she picked up a lot of waste material, and she used that in creating these illustrated pieces. That was her take on designing these. And I asked her, since she couldn't be, I asked her what the lake meant to her and why does she feel that art is so important in communicating and giving the lakes a voice. So she feels that being in a city, the fact that there are so many lakes, it provides an opportunity for urban citizens to connect with nature, to learn about nature, and that's something that we should not miss. It's we are lucky and privileged to have that within our city. And art for her is a way to communicate this and give a voice to a topic that we might take for granted. So you can tune in to our website, our social media channels on Monday, and go through the story in detail. Each alphabet will have a description along with it, which will give you some more idea about the lakes of Bangalore City. Thank you.
Thank you, Karthik. And so as in today is the last sort of culminating event for this entire project. And as part of this, a little earlier, you had a nice interaction with some of our writers. And now we will hear from two very interesting people. You'll get to interact with them as well. So it's my privilege to introduce Mr. Bittu Sagar. Let me just give you a quick introduction to him. I know all of you must have heard about him. He's a pioneering environmental activist and writer. He's a founder of Sanctuary Nature Foundation. He's also the editor of Sanctuary Asia, which is India's first and largest circulating wildlife and ecology magazine. It was started in 1981. And it has stories and photographs by scientists, conservationists, naturalists, photographers. In fact, if you've not seen the magazine, you must, because it has really the most awesome pictures. He's also the founder editor of Sanctuary Cub, which is India's well-known wildlife magazine for children. He has been closely involved with Project Tiger ever since its inception in the 70s, and he spent like decades actually writing about the issue and calling attention to a lot of conservation issues. He works with people in the government, social sector, economists, scientists, and at the intersection of biodiversity, climate change, and economics. So very, very happy to have you here, sir. Welcome. It's also wonderful to introduce Usha Ramaiah. She's somebody inspired by Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay's historic Everest climb. She got into mountaineering. She joined the Himalayan Mountaineering Institute in Darjeeling, and at 22, she became the first Karnataka woman to scale a Himalayan peak as part of an all-woman Himalayan expedition team. In 1964, she climbed the Mriktuni Peak, which is like something at 22,490 feet high. She's a founder member of the Karnataka Mountaineering Association. She's been a member of the Bharat Scouts and Guides from 1948, and she's a leader trainer for guides now. And she has been volunteering with Sanctuary Nature Foundation from 2001 as a coordinator in Bangalore for Kids for Tigers. She organizes teacher workshops, presentations, tiger-related events, nature walks, etc. And welcome to Usha Ramaiah as well. So it's been great having both of you here, and we're really looking forward to your talk. And over to you, Mr. Vitrusegar.
Well, I must say first, thank you very, very, very much. I saw the work that had been done by you in Bangalore. And let me just say to all, how old is our audience? How many do we have here, right? I mean, with us, are we talking to 12, 13, 14, 18-year-olds? Is that roughly who we are talking to? Of course, Facebook and other things, we don't know who all comes on. But if it's you young people, first let me apologize to you, seriously, from my heart, for the fact that my generation has completely and absolutely let you down. We have not looked after your world. When the colonizers left us in 1947, we thought that this country was now going to work for its people. The fact is, they may have thought they were working for the people, but we have colonized the future generations. Intergenerational colonization is real, and it's happening as we speak. There are problems, but the good thing is that unlike the Titanic, when it hit the iceberg and it sank, the biosphere can repair itself. The Titanic couldn't repair its hull. All it asks is that we flow with its tide. And everything I've heard about the project that has been done by you in Bangalore, it only reaffirms the fact that as far as the lake is concerned, you don't have to put the water through a machine and clear it up and think. You can do that because you have to want to drink it. But if you just leave it alone, and if you stop poisoning it, and if you just allow nature and use nature-based solutions, everything can be fixed. This is one. The second thing is people make a mistake and think that, oh, you know, to protect the nature and the world, we have to go far away to the Himalaya or to Africa or to the Antarctica. Start at home. Start where you are. The laws of the rainforest are working in every tree that exists in Bangalore. Every tree is an ecosystem of its own for some, between ants and beetles and butterflies and birds. And it is, Bangalore was the garden city. Bangalore has some of the finest environmentalists I've seen anywhere in this country. The thing is, we are facing a tsunami of destruction. And there are too few people trying to prevent the next tsunami and trying to get to safety those people who are affected by the tsunami which we have been hit by and is represented by climate change. I'm a member of the Buddha Party. There are two political parties. I always say, Usha, you know me. There's the Bacha Party and there's the Buddha Party. So as a card-carrying member of the Buddha Party, that apology came from me. But the fact of the matter is that to the Bacha Party, to you, I have two sworn promises. One, I will not lie to you. And two, I will not force you to become the sweepers and cleaners of the damage that we have done. I would say to you that there is something now which people like me often suffer. It's called ecological grief. Whether you see a tree in Bangalore cut, whether you see a lake which is polluted, whatever it is that you see that you don't like, you feel grief, you feel sad, you feel a loss. I found that the best way to cope with this loss is to do something about it. And it doesn't mean that you have to go into the lake and clean it. If you're an artist like Laboni Roy, use your art. If you're a poet, use your poetry. If you're a writer, use your writing. If you're an administrator, then use your position as an administrator. If you're a businessman, it's not your money, it's your influence that should be used for the city, for its environment, for its children, for its people, because nothing compares to a healthy city, an alive city. Nothing compares to that if happiness becomes your quotient, safety becomes your quotient, health becomes your quotient, good neighborliness becomes your quotient. I won't go on. I want Usha to speak really because she is the one who has lived in Bangalore. She is a global citizen, but she has lived in Bangalore. She's breathed Bangalore. And I don't think there is an environmentalist or there is a scientist or there is a child or a principal in Bangalore who does not hold her in high esteem. Usha, we say this to everybody. Just imagine what Bangalore used to be. You never needed air conditioners. And look at it now. And what is it that we want to do? We want to make Bangalore and other cities like Bombay, Delhi, all these Chennai, we want to make them future ready. Then future ready is not using carbon fuel. It is not using private cars. I have a dream for Bangalore. I want those wide footpaths. I want benches. I want drinking water fountains. I want to hear the sound of birdsong back again the way we used to. The coppersmith sound never stopped. Wherever you went, the koels in the morning never stopped. So I would say to you, all this is possible, but it needs young people, not angrily. Anger has its place, but anger can be dismissed very easily. You have the legitimacy, you young people. You have the legitimacy and you have the time, you have the strong legs. You will outlast my generation. So many of my generation, you have to chip the cement out of the head and push gray matter in. You won't have the time to do all of that, but we are going slowly. You know, we are in the departure lounge. What we want to do now is to make sure that the arrival lounge is nicely kept so you can take charge of your lives. You can take charge of your city. And I promise you, the second thing was I really, really feel that I don't have the right to foist upon you the solutions in such a way that I will go and throw a wrapper out or a plastic thing out or litter something and you will go and pick it up. So what we tell our little children, Usha will tell you this, is that they have magic eyes. When somebody throws something, we say, "Ah, uncle or auntie, you know, you threw something here. You might have needed it. It might have just been a wrapper, you know." And nobody takes offense when a child speaks. If I say the same thing to a chief minister or a prime minister or a CEO of a big company, so who are you? Why are you insulting me like this? You think I don't care? I also care for the environment. But when a child says, when a young person, a child for me is anybody under the age of 30 actually, when you say that, look, this is not what we want. What we want to is to breathe clean air. And the lakes, I mean, Bangalore's lakes are legend. Usha, please talk to these beautiful people. Kids for Tigers reaches a million children across the country. That average age group is about 10 or 12. Now, I presume this audience, you might be in class 10, 11, 12 or something like this. You're about to vote. Use that vote. Get the right people in. You'll get the right city to live in. You'll get the right hinterland of the city to live in. And I urge you all to unite. Wildlife people, social activists, unite. Because when we are divided, Punjabi mein kehte hain ki, you know, agar ghar mein jhagda ho, to kala chor aake tajori khali kar dega. If the family fights, a thief will come and empty the entire locker and all the valuables that you have in the home and may hurt you in the process. Usha, please talk to them. Tell them, because you have been my inspiration, Usha, for so many years. These kids need inspiration from you. They need heroes like you. Usha?
First of all, I must thank Meera and others from Mongabay, India, for inviting me, and Victor Sir for suggesting that I join this program today. And I've been very lucky and having lived in Bangalore from my childhood. And today, I know, like Victor says, we do feel sad that we are looking at all this development. But then it is the future. Children, it's their future. So we can't say anything, and they have to look after. We've seen, I do go out bird watching, and I have taken children out for nature trails. They are so enthusiastic to learn about all this. And I think we need to give them this opportunity. And I'm very thankful that this has been done with Mongabay India and Citizen Matters. It's so nice. We at Kids for Tigers have also been doing this with the help of Sanctuary Nature Foundation. Our Tiger Fest have attracted nearly 1,000 children, and they've all had such fun. Tiger Fest, face painting, so many other things, and children have learned over the years. Nearly 20 years I've been with them, and it's been such a wonderful journey for me. Even on from my childhood, I'm in Bangalore. So I've enjoyed what all children don't enjoy. So we should bring back such things. That's what I feel. Even I'm like a small child. I keep water on my balcony. And yesterday I was so lucky to see a gray cinereste tit come and drink water. And then I keep cotton on my balcony. And many of these bulbuls and the other birds come. This is a very simple thing. All of us can do it. I know I'm planting trees. I mean, especially native trees. We can all do it. This is what we have been asking children to do. And or in schools, how we can develop a butterfly garden, how they can plant trees. And this journey for children is also wonderful. I mean, it's their citizen, like Vito says, no, they all have magic eyes. And when something bad is happening, it's the children who have to look at these things and report it to the authorities. Because when I was in Basangudi, I used to see the slender lorries in my own garden. The chameleon, the garden lizard, I don't see it now. So we need to bring back all these things. And like we always say, no, a tree gives us all oxygen that we need for us to survive. And it absorbs carbon dioxide. Such a useful thing that it is doing. So all of us have to think of these things. I'm a tree enthusiast. Every day I plant something. I love doing such things. And I try to inculcate these ideas into children. And I don't know, this is not too late for us. We need to improve our city. Such a beautiful garden city. And we have all of us, it's a responsibility. Adults, youngsters, I do feel we have to take care of our city and not let it. I mean, there are authorities who will listen to us. Unless we go and talk to them, I mean, there are very nice people. Every time I have interacted with forest department people, they are fairly willing to help us. So we need to, we have a bird watchers group in Bangalore. They take us out to Lal Bagh, shows all the nice things that is there. So we need to, children enjoy these outings. And I'm thankful to Vittu sir for his nice magazines. Children love to read it. Not only children, even adults love to read it. So Sanctuary Asia and Sanctuary Cup has played a very big role. And even Kichwa Tigers, I'm associated. And really, really, children have, I think every year I have, I mean, met about 25,000 children in 40 schools. And it's been, I mean, I'm missing all that due to COVID. Meeting children, talking to them. A group of over 300, 400 children in schools. I'm sure they also miss me. And still, our teachers are on our online sessions. They enjoy. So we are very thankful that such a program was conducted by Monga Bay, no? Such a nice thing.
Really, Usha, I'll tell you something. With Monga Bay and with all the groups that are there in Bangalore, we will work with them. And the fact of the matter is that, I mean, it is not too late. That's the first message to send. It is not too late. As far as the magazines are concerned, Meera, here is a very specific offer. This is our 40th year. Sanctuary has been around for 40 years. Now, everybody who's listening, whether on Facebook or whether on directly with you right now, we would be very happy to gift, complimentary gift, a digital copy of Sanctuary and Cub. Every alternate month, we produce one for young naturalists, and every other day, we produce one for their parents, you know. So if all you have to do is to let Usha have the email ID and the name, but if it's a child, then the parent must approve, you know, that's the only thing. And we have a rule that no child should be writing independent emails to adults. When I say child, I don't mean nobody under 30. Now I'm talking about somebody under 12 or 13, you know. They must always copy a teacher or a parent. And we will actually get to solve this problem. The adults who are causing this problem are not bad people. They're misguided people. Of course, there are some bad people there. But those people, let the adults handle that. You young people, just keep your hearts clean, keep your head straight, keep your trust in nature going. Everything will be all right. Bangalore can come back to being a garden city. Imagine, Usha, for 1 minute, just imagine the largest open space now within almost every city in this country is the roof. And what has happened? If you go to a tall building, you see only blank roofs. Either you generate power from there or you grow food from there. And if you grow food from there, the butterflies will come. So what if a caterpillar eats a little bit of your food? Share and share alike. Nature is sharing so much with us. Nature can fix itself like a cut on your hand. And I promise you, Meera, we will work with you. It's a wonderful thing that you're doing. And as far as Maunga Bay is concerned, I cannot speak enough for you. Because at one time, Sanctuary was like a lone voice. Bombay Natural History Society was there. WWF was there. But we were too few, you know. Now, the voices are coming out. Young people are recognizing that you can have any human ambition. Any human ambition. Nothing will come to any use unless and until we return the biosphere. Unless we bring the wetlands back, the lakes back, the grasslands back. Unless we make the rivers clean again. These are the real infrastructures. The man-made infrastructures are very temporary and they are shoddy compared to what we can do. I'm not saying we should go in a cave and grow our beards long if you're a man and just go there and sit. I'm not saying we become hunter-gatherers. I'm just saying, let us be a little bit smarter. Darwin said something simple. I'll end on that. Darwin said that it is not the strongest. It is not even the most intelligent that will survive. It is the most adaptable. Are we adaptable as human beings? As we grow older, we become less adaptable. Our habits, our food habits, our friendships, our everything. Nature is sending us a message now. It is not sending us any judgment. COVID-19, the Dasgupta review. If you haven't read that, kids, even if you're 14, 15 years old, type in the Dasgupta review. COVID-19 was a direct result of the wildlife trade and the destruction of ecosystems. It's entirely possible from some Chinese lab in Wuhan, somebody got a poke or slight got an infection and things. But the diseases are called zoonotic diseases, transferred from animals to humans. This includes AIDS, SARS, MERS, Ebola, swine flu, bird flu. All these came because we ill-treated animals and we ill-treated their homes. All these animals were locked into this. A tree is an ecosystem. A bat wants to live in a tree, doesn't want to come into your house. So if we allow biodiversity to flourish in the city and in the city's hinterland and even far from us, please believe me, the world will come back to balance and we have to spend less time. The best Usha, the best planters of trees, the scatterers of seeds other than the wind and the rain and water are the animals, the birds, the bees, the butterflies, the monkeys, the wild boars, and they plant exactly the food that their children will need. So they don't have the technology to waste. Humans are the only animal in the world, and we are just bumped up monkeys. We are the only ones with the technology to waste. So a little humility, a little trust in nature, and a little courage to speak, but speak politely. No child should speak rudely to an adult, irrespective of how much damage that adult is doing. And if you are under the age of 16, 18, you take permission before you do things which might in any way put you in harm's way, or don't go out and do any kind of bahaduri and all that. You just focus on having a good life right now, but just remind the Buddha party, this is my world. I know you love me very much. I know you want to give me a 5-star hotel and 10-lane highway and you want to do all this, but really what we want is clean air, safe food, and an environment that we can hear bird song rather than hear ka ka cuckoo ta ta to 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 of traffic and smoke and this and that and the other, and have a lovely life. There's nothing more complicated than this, Usha. You and I have been doing this for 20 years, and these kids will do it for another 50 years. I promise you, when we go, these kids will do this. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
No, thank you all for organizing this.
Thank you so much. And that was a wonderful offer. We'll actually, you know, communicate that to all the participants of the contest and as well. I just have one question and then request all the audience here to share their questions here as well. Tell me one thing. We're talking about climate change. We're talking about the clock ticking. And you've described your generation, perhaps mine too, as homo stupidus. We're still continuing this as business as usual. If you look at the, you know, the public space, everybody is going back now that, you know, lockdown restrictions are lifted, and we just back to our usual, like, you know, the traffic and whatnot, pollution and whatnot. How do you think the next generation can be like wiser? We have to think out of the box, right? We're literally running to stay in the same place at this point.
See, the next generation will not be able to do many of the things that this generation is doing. I have the advantage of having worked here for half a century, okay? And I know for a fact that when we started out with Sanctuary, I was accused of being a CIA spy. I said, CIA spy? Me? Why? Because you are against the development and industrialization of India, and India has to be powerful. Now, I'm saying to you right now, anybody who goes on the internet will know that oil, coal, gas is dead on its feet. Carbon energy is dead on its feet. The people who are hardcore carbon energy guys are all rushing. There's a big queue of people going in for solar and wind. The big problem now is that they're going with that attitude where they want to centralize solar, they want to centralize wind, and then from there they want to distribute it. So we are telling them, Baba, listen, and this is what the kids can do, and this is what the kids will do. The sun shines in a very decentralized way. Why don't we decentralize our collective, our solar panels, and use them locally? Why should we take the water from the Himalaya and send it to Delhi? Should Delhi not be able to run its own water supply through roof collection, through the Yamuna that is already flowing by? Why do you want to destroy the Himalaya? The same way, Bangalore, where is your water coming from? It's coming from the Kaveri, correct? Now, if you look at the Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, if they were different countries, they might go to war over water. But nobody is looking to protect that beautiful forest in the Western Ghats that produces the water. So if we unite, I'm promising you, you asked me a short question, I gave you a rather too long an answer, but the fact is that the children will live better lives because, number one, the Buddha Party will not have the money. There's something called risk premium. Very few people think about this. Risk premium is how much insurance companies charge you and at what risk. They are not prepared to finance nuclear reactors because the risk is too high. They are not prepared now to finance dams in the Himalaya. 10 large dams now, the people are going, kaan pakad ke, sorry, we don't want to build this dam. Now, government, you take it over. Are they made all the money with the contractors. Now they want us to take it over. So you children, please understand. Many of the damaging things that are being done by my generation now, they won't be able to do. But within you also, you will have to use your intelligence, your good heart, your eyes, and be a collective. Don't get divided. If you get divided, you will get lost. But you will not be lost because you have sharp minds and you have clean hearts and you have good eyesight and you have determination on your side, and nature is your best friend. The best superhero. You can have Superman, Batman, Iron Man, Hanuman, you have anybody you want. But the best superhero is Mother Nature, and it's on your side. And I tell this even to ministers when I meet. And they say, yes. But then I don't know whether they do yes. Okay, I'm sorry. That was too long an answer for a too short a question, but I couldn't resist it.
Thank you. I'm sure, a lot of students here have been part of many of the environmental campaigns. You may have volunteered at your local lake or, shared stuff about climate change on Instagram. Would anybody like to share your experiences? Have you participated in any of the Fridays for Future, like candlelight stuff? Sort of, yeah. Rakshan, do you want to say what you've done?
So my school has basically run these campaigns to buy a tiger for a zoo. And so I participated in that, and I sold shirts and other stuff for that.
Okay. To support, yeah. I think even the last 1 or 2 years, we've seen a lot of requests from our zoos, the Banagata and the Mysore zoos, requesting public to support, maintenance of the animals.
May I interject?
I know you want to comment on the zoos. Yes,
I want to comment on this. My dear Beta, listen to me. The zoo is not an educational, nature education center. The zoos have a great role to play. But that is to make sure that when animals are down to very few numbers, they can do captive breeding and then release them in the wild. That is the zoos are not, the animals are not meant to entertain us, number one. And number two, just imagine, suppose somebody, we had a talk, a serious talk, and good people want to make zoos. But the fact of the matter is that if zoos could give nature education, then we should do anti-crime education. You know, crime doesn't pay by taking people to the jail and showing them people behind bars. Does it work? It doesn't work. That's not the way in which animals should be perceived. But listen, most of the zoos have the best campuses. They are botanical gardens. They are beautiful places. I would say that some degree of some animals which are there, it could be a croc somewhere, it could be a snake somewhere, it could be, you know, ants somewhere. There are many things. And if you make the place nice, I can tell you that in Mumbai, we have a zoo over here that we have been trying to suggest should be a botanical garden. There are more than 2,000 bats that come. And watching those bats, you can spend the whole time anyway. No? I'd put it to you like that. Just let nature be free, just the same way as you wouldn't like to sit in your school, in your class every single day. Animals would also like to have a different experience every single day.
Aniru, do you want to add about that? You shared about your trip to BRT Sanctuary and you were quite keen on the big cats. Do you want to add anything to that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. No, you in the last session, you actually talked about your fascination with the tigers and the big cats, yes. Right?
Yes.
So do you want to add to what Bittu sir actually mentioned, talked about? What is your take?
I just want to, you know, spread awareness that you need to conserve every single species, not only the, you know, the endangered ones, every single thing. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
Very well said, Beta. Very, very well said.
Thank you, sir.
So, but anybody has questions for Bittu or Usha? Do you want to share your experience as well? I've seen some of the entries, like people have actually really, you know, spent time observing things in their own balcony. I remember, I think, was it... Tarini, who talked about like just all the trees in her own garden and what she can see there. Tarini, you want to just share your experiences or talk about your, share your thoughts?
I'm being in lockdown and whatnot, I've actually gotten to see the birds around my home and my room, which I usually don't get to see while I'm at school.
Wow.
But even in school, we have a great campus and we also get tons of birds, lots of animals. So even though I don't see what comes nearby my house most of the time, in school as well, it's a great, great sightings to do. Okay.
Wonderful, wonderful. How lovely to hear this.
Sir, would you like to talk about a little bit about the Project Tiger and how, the activities that you do in schools in between you and Usha, and how students can participate, and how does it matter specifically to, you know, to understand in the context of living in cities?
Usha, do you want to take that?
Actually, I think I did not get the correct
basically,
the Kids for Tigers, your project, yeah. Kids for Tigers, and how does it connect to people living in the cities? We're all urbanites here.
We sensitize children into how they can save the tiger. See, when you save the tiger which is in the forest, you know, you save other animals. Like somebody said, they're interested in saving everything. So not only that, we save our water sources because trees absorb water and then it flows into rivers. Now today, because of the cutting down of trees, our water sources are reducing in the rivers. So this we do through various programs. When we have a teacher workshop, we sensitize the children and the teachers And then we have a presentation which is sent by Sanctuary Nature Foundation. We show them all the different biodiversity areas, and then we need to tell them how we can save these various animals and other things. And also we take them out for nature walks. They actually see the plants and learn about these plants and how it is useful to us.
And how can students reach out to you?
Actually, the whole of Bangalore, if you ask me, is almost like a bird sanctuary. You cannot go more than 1 kilometer away and you can go birding, you know, somewhere or the other. The bird watching is one of the things that in the city you can do. But more important than that, I mean what I say. What we tell the children is that, look, as far as the city is concerned, the laws of the jungle work here as well. And as far as Bangalore is concerned, the city kids have a huge role to play in protecting animals far away and habitats far away, as well as in your city. What is to stop? Suppose there is a venerable old tree somewhere and somebody says, chop it off. Now, all you'd have to do is get one photograph of 20 children around the tree, hugging it, put it down. Deccan Herald or somebody or the other publishes it. Now you've got social media. It becomes that much more difficult. Do the appropriate things. And in the city, I promise you kids, that if you go out, let's say you and your parents, you're locked down for so long. Just looking at a tree, you can do an experiment at home. If your mom's blood pressure, your mom's pulse or your dad's pulse is, let's say, 80. You just stare at the tree for 1 minute, take 4 deep breaths, it'll come down to 75, 76, 77. You become calm, you know. The city, the Japanese call it forest bathing. You don't have to go to forest bathe. Just go to Cobbon Park, you know. And similarly, I don't know how many of you have seen the Saraki Lake. How do you pronounce it? Is that how it's pronounced?
Saraki.
Saraki. So, I mean, just look at that. Go there. You'll see pelicans. You'll see so many things. There are people who are looking to protect it. And they need you children just to give them support. So, it's not that some Buddha party is going to protect the lake. No, it's a Bacha party. It's your lake. It's your water. And I'll tell you one thing, when you have a lake in a city, you need to have it graded, you know. There are some animals that want deep water, there are some animals that want shallow water. So if more you learn about nature in your city, the quicker you'll understand that a lake, they're putting a cement wall around a lake and saying there's water inside, that's not a lake, huh? Better than nothing, but that's not a lake. That becomes like a small swimming pool. But if you have mud banks, if you have grass, if you have bushes, you have overhanging trees, you have kingfishers coming there, you have fish inside, you have tadpoles, you have frogs, all these are the gardeners of our Eden. They are the ones, they are the engineers that engineer a good life for us in city or in Banarghatta or in Banarghatta. By the way, the zoo is a tiny place. Huh? There are wild elephants over there. Real Banarghatta is the forest. There is no purpose in thinking that by protecting, an animal in a cage, it will give you anything other than the fact that you have to feed it all day. Nobody feeds wild animals. They feed themselves. Nature feeds them. Learn those lessons. And if you just keep a little water in your balcony, a little bit of greenery, you protect this thing, that thing, just see to it. Don't let your cats out loose because they eat fledglings. Little things like that. Please believe me. You will have a wonderful life, and the city kids are very important for saving wildlife in the city, as well as protecting their own life by protecting the sources of your water far away. Lamba answer, chota question. What to do?
Yeah, I see Anvita and Layashri raising their hands. Can you just unmute and
yes, ma'am,
ask your question?
Yeah. So it's really inspiring to listen to Usha ma'am and Bittu Sahagal sir. So my question is, you know, it's really great to see that people who are, you know, about the margin of 30 years or even about 20 years, open to the idea of that, you know, this is a need and needs to be tackled. But there are many people who are not even open to the idea, and they are in their own box thinking that the world is only for material comforts. And they don't think that, you know, there's this other dimension that the harm they have caused or they're experiencing. So how do you bring awareness to them? Because at last, even if we find a solution to everything, to implement it, we need to change the mindset of the people that are causing this harm. So I want to know, is there a way to change the mindset?
My dear, wonderful, wonderful girl, I'll tell you this. The best way to change mindsets is to do something that others can see and they will follow you. Most people are hesitant to do what they don't do. When they see young children going up and, let's say, looking after or protecting a tree, suddenly the parents begin to feel, the others feel, even those people who disagree with you. Please remember, you can disagree, but you don't have to be disagreeable. You know, you go to them and speak and write letters, write to editors, write to Mongabay. Of course, you don't have to write to. They will write for you, you know. They are so strongly committed to protecting the environment. But write to Deccan Herald, write to newspapers in other places, write to the Prime Minister, always polite letters. Say, this is what it is. Learn about the trees. Learn about the life. Let me tell you something. This is for, I don't know how old you are, my little girl, but the fact is that, let's suppose you were 5-8 years younger. What do we say? Wouldn't you like to live in a magic home? Your doors are made of chocolate. Your windows are made of lollipop. You open the tap, you get some nice meetha lemonade. Every stone you see outside your house is a chocolate. You can eat it. And when you go to sleep, next day, everything comes back. And they say, yes, Bittu uncle, we would love to see you. We'd love to live in a home like that. I said, but every langur lives in a home like that. Every monkey, every bird lives in a home, eats off the tree and lives in the tree. And if I destroyed your home, magic home, would you be happy? No, no, we would not be happy. So listen, to convince other people, first let them know you value something. They think it's useless, genuinely think it's useless. And if you are able to convince, and if there are enough of you, if one voice speaks, in the strong wind, it gets lost. When 50 voices come, no wind can stop you. No strong wave can stop you. You can become a wall in defense of nature. I really tell you, this is your time. This is your time. You can, and we have not gone beyond the point of no return. So don't worry about convincing others. I'll end again by telling you something that was told to me by a very wonderful man called Baba Amte and Shivram Karant. We were sitting together and I had said to them exactly the question you asked about 30 years ago. And I said, how do we convince people? They won't listen, you know, even though they know it's wrong, they still do it wrong. You know what Baba Amte said to me? He said, you want people to follow you, right? How are they going to follow you if you keep chasing them? Just do what you do. They will follow you because they were waiting for a leader to come. And you are the leaders of tomorrow. That's my answer.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Anvita, you had a question, Anvita.
Yeah, it was actually, I wanted to share an experience more than a question. So, there are two things I wanted to say. So the first thing is that I am really lucky right now in the layout I live in. It's in Bangalore itself. And it's a layout called Prestige Glenmorgan. And over there, the empty plots where you're supposed to build your own house. And thankfully, still a lot of plots have been left vacant for years. And we have like big trees and we have green beaters and silver bills coming here. And it's since I've taken part in the competition. So since I got the passion in photography, it's given me a huge pedestal because I just go out for a half an hour walk and I can come back with 10 photos, wow. Right? And that's something I wanted to share. And the second thing is that I have been going to the same school for the past 13 years, Prakriya, Green Wisdom School. And over there, since nursery, they take us for nature walks, first in the campus, then when we grow up outside the campus. And even the field trips are in places like Sharavati or Kegel and all that stuff. So I just wanted to tell that I think it's because of all these little things that I've been a part of since childhood that I actually connect a lot with nature. And if this happens for, I think, every kid in the future and right now also, then it will change the world.
All right. How Thank absolutely you. Right. Lovely, lovely, lovely to hear that. Yes.
Thank you for sharing that, Anvita. Because you want to share anything about what you think schools should be doing, and perhaps many of the parents and the principals or teachers listening to this could try something as well.
See, I have two daughters and I have three grandsons, and everybody says the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world, but the fact is that when my daughters' children grew up and were able to go to school, I can tell you I was there to see the celebration in their voice because they got a little life back. So as far as teachers and parents are concerned, I would say to you that children don't do what you tell them to do. You already know that. They do what you do. set a good example, actually change a few of the values and get the happiness from that. And as far as the school is concerned, any school, I would say first start with making a butterfly garden, the simplest thing in the world. Just a few things. Let them learn. Your biology teacher can tell you, your botany teacher can tell you, your science teacher can tell you. Once you do that, just get the maths teacher to figure out, okay, this is the total roof area. This is the amount of rain that falls. This is the amount of water that can be gathered. This is the potential amount of water harvesting we can do. Okay, we can't do the whole 100%. We'll do 4% of it. You're walking in the right path. Get somebody to come out into your school and do a biodiversity assessment and see on the roof how much more can you enhance that. Do a bird watching if you have a campus in the school. And I would really love it. I would really tell you that both teachers and parents will be enriched if the homework that you give kids has something to do with nature as well. If it's an essay that they have to write, tell them to write about a tree. Tell them to look at a tree and write anything that comes to mind. If it's art, it's the same thing. Try to bring nature into their lives because children thrive on nature. They murjhao. They children feel sad when they see something beautiful being destroyed, and even sadder when they see adults doing that. And then the thought comes, what can I do? I'm just one person. One person can change the world. You don't believe that? Find out the life of Margaret Mead. Find out the life of Gandhi. And you have in Karnataka some of the most fantastic poets. I just miss that beautiful man, Shivram Karant. If you could just read what he wrote for the next 2000 years. People should read that wonderful man's thought processes. Teachers, you have a responsibility and you have joy in your lives. You have these ambassadors, your children. They are all your missiles. Let them loose into the world with the right values and leave them to do diverse things. We don't want, monocultures of minds, just like we don't want monocultures of trees. Let 1,000 ideas bloom. Give them the right values. Give them the encouragement. Let them be who they wish to be.
Thank you. Vasanthi, you want to...
I would like to...
Children
go out nature walks. Parents can also enjoy. That's what I've seen. Once or twice when they come along with the children, they enjoy. They also want to learn. And even at home, apart from schools, you can have plants, involve the parents to do these things. So they will definitely get into your mood and they will also enjoy. This is how we can, I have been doing this with many people. I just tell them, keep on telling them, do this, sending them sanctuary magazines, then sending messages about what I saw. And it's really, people get into this mood. Definitely you can multiply. Teachers are with us for nearly 20 years. There are some of them. And they motivate their own children. It's really good. We can do it, like Vitu sir said. Not late at all.
Thank you, ma'am. Vasanthi, I see your hand raised. You want to just pipe in?
First of all, the privilege of hearing both of you, Usha ma'am and Sehgal ji. My question to Mr. Sehgal is the poster that we see behind you, Tiger, Tiger, Burning Bright. is there a story there? Where is that from? And the second is that your childhood, I mean, how did you get into the path? Were you like a born, nature lover? Was it from your parents? Or where did you grow up? A little bit of your story, please. Thank you.
There is never any one thing, Vasanthi. There are thousands of things. But first of all, that tiger there is not a tiger. The tiger is a metaphor. The tiger is a metaphor for all of nature. That's not a photograph. That is an artwork done by the Ranthambore School of Art.
Wow.
With a single hairbrush. These are the people who do things from Mughal miniatures. They make these large paintings.
Yes.
They went in and they earn a living now. A lot of people. So as I said, it's the artists, it's the poets, it's the thinkers. These are the people who are going to change the world, you know. So come here. This is the boy, my grandson. And Rudra is one of the people that I tell you something, every day I learn from him. And wow. Rudra, this is teachers and people like this are listening in to us. Here's another one.
Hello.
Hi. Hi.
Here's another one. So you see, these are our missiles for tomorrow.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So, perhaps you'll have to do that. So what I'm saying is that I honestly tell you that, I mean, my childhood was not a wild childhood. I grew up in a beautiful place called Shimla. I was born there. And there our school, large school campus, there were hyenas outside and this and that. We took them all for granted. When I went back 10, 15 years later to school, to Shimla, my heart broke. I actually sat in a corner and wept. I couldn't stop sobbing for the destruction. I didn't even know that I loved the forest as much as I loved it till that day, because I used to protect and defend and things like this. But I would put it to you like this. Every single child is a potential conservationist tomorrow, but that conservationist poet, conservationist writer, conservationist engineer, conservationist businessman, conservationist politician. I wish the word environmentalist was removed from the dictionary. All of us have to do what we do. And in my case, I can tell you this very clearly. It wasn't easy, but every day was a challenge. And the business of trying to protect, it kept ecological grief at bay. When you sit down over there and you passively just get attacked, it's one thing. You just, every time I see a tree in an urban area that is still surviving, I feel it's like a revolution. I feel like this is really what, we protected that tree, you know. Just do a little bit. It's like medicine for you. It's medicine for your heart, for your soul, for your mind, for your body. Walk if you can. Fight for footpaths. And you go to the gym if you have to, but climb a tree. It's better. Better exercise, you know. We're all primates anyway. Listen, again, I'm going on too long. There must be other questions. And time is also running out, I think, for you all.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity. I in the previous session that I was moderating, I was saying that Meera and, you know, Gopi Varia Mongabe, the teams have done something so beautiful in creating this window for all of us. Meera, just one half a question can I ask Mr. Sehgal? I know we are running out of time. Just to say that what you were saying for children, what I loved was the everyday little things that you can do. It's not like you suddenly have to become this lofty figure who has to go into the forest to become an environmentalist. I really loved that. But I was also sharing one experience with my little niece who's very passionate about nature. She was telling me, saying that she wants to save the sea turtle. You know, she's inspired by some YouTube icons that she sees. But, you know, in terms of, let's say, the consumerism that we are getting the kids into, in the huge packaging, the food particularly, every second day there's something food that comes home. You know, we just at the click of a button, we order huge packaging, which takes up trees and, you know, it's a whole cycle. How do we make this lesson easier for our children, for our policy makers? Is there any thought from our side, from your side, for us in the media?
There is. First of all, there was one thing that Gandhi said that very few people actually quote. He said, the person who does nothing because they can't do everything is the worst of the lot. I'm transcribing his words. He says, do what you can do. Because if a lot of us do a lot gets done. So suppose there are 5 parcels that are coming every day wrapped in plastic, wrapped in this, Amazon is putting this, putting that. By and large, try and see if you can get things locally, if you can.
Mm.
Otherwise, if the person comes, get the message back, put that back, give that to him, take your thing out and say, please dispose this off yourself because we don't want it. Write a letter to Amazon. Write a letter to the people who are doing it. You may think it doesn't mean much, but please believe me, the messages when they come from 60,000 people, companies will change their policy. They have options, but they use either the cheapest option, the quickest option, the most convenient one. Just do the right thing and do what you can do. My two grandsons who came here today, the one thing I tell them is when you brush your teeth, you mustn't hear the water in the tap. A small trickle of water when you wash your hands also. Now everybody's washing their hands. I said it takes a little longer to take the soap off, but you use less water and you wash your hands more thoroughly. Small little things. The children, when they absorb them now, they are so small. As they grow older and older and more powerful, They will grow up. They won't be doing the right thing. They won't be producing factories and goods that will destroy. Just give them the right compass now. And give it with love.
Wow, yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Usha Aro and Mr. Sehgal. Thank you, Meera.
Thank you so much. Just want to mention one thing, like the whole approach that we at Citizen Matters have is that each one of us can become a change maker. Each one of us is a problem solver. So like Vitru sir and Usha have said, like each of us can do something in our own lives, in our own apartment complex or community or neighborhood. In fact, we've had many of our articles are authored by citizen journalists. So we have a combination of both, you know, professionals who go out and, you know, investigate, dig deep into issues and share that. And we also have citizen journalists sharing their stories. And we've had many young people actually share their experiences. For example, a couple of months ago, we had a young school student analyzing public transport and actually sharing that as an article. We've had somebody else writing about how they created a food garden. These are all young people, whatever, 14, 15, 16. There is so much that people, teenagers and students can do nowadays. And please feel free to share your stories. Citizen Matters is an open platform meant for, you know, for us to understand our cities better, to make a difference to our own cities. So that's an open call for all of you. So continue sharing your stories. We've had some great submissions and it is time now for me to hand it over to Ekta and Ashika to talk about the contest and what they found there.